Hi, this is Ravi Verma, and in this video I'm going to start the first chapter of chemistry for class 9th from your NCERT textbook. The title of the chapter is Matter in Our Surrounding. Dear students, in this video I will cover every fact, every concept and definitions from your textbook. So this video is enough in order to understand the theory of this chapter completely. While watching this video, you should open your NCERT textbook, and after every topic that has been discussed by me, you need to pause the video and read the topic from your NCERT textbook. So dear students, while doing this, you need to underline the important facts in your textbook and also make your notes, topic wise notes, in your science copies. So let us start with the first topic of this chapter, matter. So first of all, what is matter? The definition is that matter is anything which occupies space and has mass. Dear students, everything in this universe is made up of material which the scientists have named matter. The air we breathe, food we eat, stones, clouds, stars, plants, animals, and even a small drop of water or a particle of sand, everything is matter. One thing that is common in all these things is that they occupy space and has mass. They have mass. So dear students, matters are anything which can actually be felt by any of your senses. For example, a matter can be felt by touch, or a matter can be felt by smell. Okay, so you need to memorize this definition that matter occupies space and has mass. Now let's discuss about the classification of matter. The early Indian philosophers have classified matter into 5 basic elements which are called panch tattva. These panch tattva are air, earth, fire, sky, water. But on the basis of physical state, the matter is classified into solid, liquids and gases. Now on the basis of chemical composition, means what is their composition, the matter is divided into pure substances and mixtures. Now the mixtures may be of two types, one are homogeneous and the other are heterogeneous. We'll discuss about these terms, homogeneous, heterogeneous, pure substance and mixtures later in this chapter or in the next chapter also. Now let's move on to the next topic, that is physical nature of matter. Dear students, the early thinkers have thought that matter is a uniform, or we can say is continuous like a block of wood. Whereas some other people have thought that the matter is made up of particles. But the actual fact is that the matter is made up of particles which are very small. So what is the physical nature of matter? Matter is made up of particles, and the particles are very tiny. They are so much tiny that is beyond our imagination. Okay, now particles of matter have space between them and they are continuously moving. And not only this, the particles of matter also attract each other. So these are a few features of matter, that is physical nature of matter, that the matter is made up of particles which are very tiny, which have space between them, and they are continuously moving, and they attract each other. Now we are going to learn about them by the help of activity. First of all, how we come to know that matter is made up of particles. In order to understand this, we can perform one activity. First of all, in a beaker, we'll take water, and we'll mark the label of the water there in the beaker, as I have done here. Now we'll add a little salt in it, and we'll mix the salt, or we can also take sugar. We'll mix the salt, we'll try to dissolve it with the help of a glass rod. Now, even after the salt or the sugar has been dissolved in water, you will see that the level of water is still not raised. Means yet still the level of water is same as it was earlier before the mixing of salt. So where has this salt or sugar gone? Actually, the particles of salt or sugar have gone into the spaces between the particles of water. And this is why that empty space was occupied by the salt, and this is why the level of water did not increase. So from this activity, we come to know that both salt and water are made up of a very large number of particles. Okay, now let's move on to the next topic, that is, particles of matter are very tiny. How do we come to know that the particles are very small? We can have a clue by doing this activity. First of all, we'll take 100 ml water in a beaker, and we'll take very small number of crystals, like 2 or 3 crystals of potassium permanganate. So when we'll dissolve these crystals into 100 ml water, we'll see that the color of 100 ml water has become pinkish or violet or purple. So now we will take 10 ml of this solution into a test tube, and we will add this 10 ml solution into another fresh 100 ml water put in another beaker. Now we will say that again the whole 100 ml water, all the 100 ml water that was fresh, has got some color, that is pink in color. Now we see that only 2-3 crystals have colored 100 ml plus 100 ml, total 200 ml water, means the color have been given to 200 ml water. But we do not stop here only. We'll take again the 10 ml from this and add it to 100 ml fresh water. Again we will say another 100 ml has got pink color. Now we'll take another 10 ml from this beaker, and we'll add this 10 ml again into fresh 100 ml water. So here we see that we have taken total 1, 2, 3, 4. 400 ml water has been taken, and we see that this large amount of water can be given pinkish color because of only 2-3 crystals. How is this possible? This is possible because crystals of potassium permanganate are made up of very large number of very tiny and small particles. When these crystals are dissolved into the water, they keep breaking down, means the crystals keep breaking down into its constituent particles. These particles get separated from each other and get mixed or intermixed with the particles of water. So when we do this serial dilution again and again, again and again, again and again, the particles of potassium permanganate break down into smaller and smaller particles. And this is why a very large number of potassium permanganate particles is generated while they are dissolved in water. And this is why a very large number, very large amount of water has been given a color. So from this activity, we come to know that particles of matter are very tiny, very small. Now, come to the next topic, that particles of matter have space between them. How we can say that the particles of matter have space between them? By doing this activity. Look, this activity is same as we have done in the first topic. Means we have taken water, we have noted a level of the water in the beaker, we have dissolved salt in it, and even after dissolving salt, the level did not rise. From this activity, we came to the conclusion that the matter like water and salt are made up of particles. And we also come to know that the particles of sugar have occupied the space between the particles of water. Again, listen to what I'm saying, that particles of sugar or particles of salt, whatever we dissolve, occupy the space between the particles of water. So from this activity, we come to this conclusion that particles of matter have space between them. Now let's move on to the next one, that particles of matter are continuously moving. What we will do, we'll take water in a beaker and we will add a few drops of ink into it slowly, and preferably along the sides of the beaker. So when we have added a few drops of ink, blue or black ink we can take, and we'll leave it for a few hours. After a few hours, you will see that initially the ink was at certain place, but with the time you will see that the ink has spread throughout the water and a large amount of water has taken color because of it. What does it show? That the ink is spreading here and there. The particles of ink are spreading here and there. This shows that the particles of ink are moving continuously along with the particles of water. This is why the ink has diffused in water. Dear students, here we see that the particles of ink and the particles of water are intermixing with each other spontaneously. So this intermixing of two or more different types of matters or the particles of matters spontaneously, automatically, is called diffusion. Now there is another definition of diffusion. The definition is that particles of any matter, or we can say the particles of every matter, have a tendency to move from region of their high concentration to region of their low concentration. So always a substance moves, or we can say the particles of substance always move from region of high concentration to region of low concentration. This is called diffusion. So there are two definitions of diffusion given here. One is spontaneous intermixing of two or more substances is called diffusion. And the another definition is that the particles of a matter move from region of high concentration to region of low concentration spontaneously. Okay, now let's come to another conclusion that we can draw, that is, particles of matter attract each other. How can we come to know? We have to take three things. One is iron nail, then a piece of chalk and a rubber band, and we try to break them. We'll see that it is more easy to break a chalk, less easy to break a rubber, and very difficult to break an iron nail. Why? What does it show? That the particles of iron nail are very tightly packed with each other. Means they have been attracted very tightly to each other. They have a very large amount of force of attraction, very strong forces of attraction between the particles. That's why it is hard to break iron nail. But comparative to this, the particles of a rubber have a little bit weaker forces of attraction, and the particles of chalk have more weaker forces of attraction. So from this activity, we know that the particles of matter attract each other, and this force of attraction may be stronger in some substances but weaker in some other substances. Now let's talk about the different states. The different states of matter. Dear students, states of matter means physical states of matter. So there are three physical states of matter. One is solid, liquid, and gas. Now, dear students, we are going to discuss about these the properties of these states. First of all, let's start with what are solids and the properties of solids. Here you see, this is a solid box, means a box made up of solid material, and you see that it has a definite shape and also it has a fixed volume. For example, you take a duster and you will see that it has a definite shape and it has a definite volume that it occupies. So dear students, solids have a definite shape and fixed volume. They have definite boundaries also. Because they have definite shape, that means they have definite boundaries. Now, other features of solids are that space between the particles is minimum, means they are very densely packed, and force of attraction between the particles of solids is maximum, means they are very tightly packed. Here you can see that the particles are very tightly packed and the space between the particles is very less. So because they are very tightly packed, the movement of the particles is minimum. What does it show? That the diffusion of the particles will be least, means they will diffuse very less. So rate of diffusion is very less, or we can say minimum in them. Now look at this fifth this point, the fifth one, they are least compressible. They are least compressible. What does it show? First of all, you have to understand the term compressibility. Compressibility. Let me write it once again. What is the term? This is compressibility. What is compressibility? Dear students, compressibility means when you press something and its volume is decreased. This is called compressibility. Means when you apply pressure on some matter and the volume decreased. Volume is decreased by applying pressure. This is called compressibility. For example, we can compress the gases. You know that in a cylinder, in a gas cylinder, a large amount of gas is in compressed form. Means a large volume of gas was there initially and we have applied pressure on it and it decreased in volume. So this is called compressibility. So solids are not compressible, or we can say they are least compressible. There is another property of solid that is called rigidity. R-I-G-I-D-I-T-Y. Rigidity. Dear students, the writing, my handwriting is not so bad, but writing it with the help of a stylus is very hard. So that's why it is not clear what I am writing. So rigidity. What is rigidity? Dear students, you take a duster or any other solid, for example, a key. Okay, and you try to apply some pressure on it and try to change its shape. You will find that the shape of a solid is, to change the shape of a solid is very hard. Means solids resist the change in their shape. This property of solid is called rigidity. Again, what I'm saying, if we apply pressure on a solid, then what the solid will do? Solid will resist the change in its shape. This property of solid is called rigidity. Alright, now let's come to the next state, that is liquid state. Properties of liquids. Okay, dear students, here you can see in the bottle there is a liquid. Now, if you pour this water, this liquid from this type of bottle into this type of pot, what you will see? That it has got the shape like this. Like this. So here you can see that initially when the liquid was there in the bottle, its shape was that of the bottle. Now when it has been filled or poured into this type of pot, here you can see that the shape of the liquid has taken the shape of this pot. So what we can say that the liquids have no definite shape and they take the shape of the container in which they are kept. Hope this fact is very clear to you now, that the liquids do not have a fixed shape and the shape of a the liquids take the shape of the container in which they are kept, but they have a fixed volume. Means if initially the volume of water or liquid in this bottle was 50 ml and when you pour it into another type of container, yet the volume of this liquid will be 50 ml only. So we can say that the liquids have a fixed volume. Now let's come to other features of liquids. The space between the particles of matter, particles of liquids is intermediate. What does it show? That the space between the particles of a liquid is more as compared to solids. And why the space is larger? Because the force of attraction between the particles is intermediate. That means there is relatively lesser force of attraction between the particles as compared to solids. Now the movement of particles is also intermediate. That means we know that the movement of particles of a liquid is more as compared to solids. In a liquid, the particles are moving here and there, here and there, here and there, but within a certain volume. But within a certain volume. So we can say that the particles of a liquid are rapidly moving from one place to another place. They are moving from one place to another place, but they are not leaving their volume. Okay. If we talk about the movement of particles of a solid, then the solid particles are just vibrating at a fixed position. They are not moving from one place to another place, but they are just vibrating. The position of the particles is fixed, but on that position, they are just simply vibrating. Okay, now they are less compressible. Actually, the liquids, we can say they are incompressible. Means there is no compressibility in liquids. Similarly, their rate of diffusion is more than solids. Why? Because the particles are moving fastly. They are loose, right? And force of attraction between the particles is less. That's why the particles can move easily. And this is said to be that the rate of diffusion is more as compared to solids. Okay, now properties of gases. Dear students, the gases are much different as compared to solids and liquids. How they are much different? They are different because they do not have a fixed shape. Obviously, they don't have a fixed shape. Any gas doesn't have a fixed shape. Means you can fill the gas in any type of container and it will take the shape of that container. Another thing is that they don't even have a fixed volume. Their volume also changes. For example, you see that in the gas cylinders that we use in our kitchen, okay, they are kept in a small volume as long as they are inside the cylinder. But if you open the nozzle of the cylinder, you will see that the gas is spreading throughout the room or throughout the home. Means it is occupying the volume of whole the room or whole the home. So this is how we can say that the volume of a gas is not fixed. They can be kept in any type of container. Any type of volume. In the cylinder, their volume is very less. But when they are opened, when they are released from the cylinder, their volume increases and they occupy the whole volume of the room. So what we can say that the gases occupy the whole volume or each and every corner of the container in which they are kept, because the particles are moving very rapidly from one place to other place in a limitless manner, we can say. There is no limit wherever a gaseous molecule can go. Now, what we can say that the space between the particles is maximum. It is maximum in gases. And force of attraction is least. That's why they are not kept at one place. They are moving here and there. Because force of attraction is very less. Now, the movement of particles is maximum. This we have already discussed. And they are most compressible. This you need to understand. What is compressibility? Again, I have told you what is compressibility. Once again, I am going to discuss this. Once again, dear students, in your book on page number 5, on page number 5, figure number 1.4, you will find an activity in which you have taken a syringe, that syringe that is used for medical purposes, and if you take out the piston of the syringe and then again put the piston inside the syringe, something like this. Suppose this is syringe and this is the piston. Right, something like this, there is a piston. So when you take out the piston, now you know that in this part there is a gas. Now when you insert the piston, you see that you close this opening. You need to close this opening. Okay, now you take out the piston and then you put the piston once again. So you will see that the air will be compressed. Means the volume of the air has been reduced to this amount only. So I think that from this diagram the things are not clear. So let me explain you that volume of a gas can be decreased by applying its pressure. That's why we can say that gases are highly compressible. Okay, so from this diagram I think the things are not clear. Okay, now their rate of diffusion is more than solids and liquids. What we can say that the rate of diffusion is maximum in gases. Why? Because the particles are moving. The movement of particles is maximum. That's why the rate of diffusion is also maximum in gases. So dear students, what you need to do? This is your homework of today, that you have to make a table differentiating the solids, liquids and gases on the basis of these features. This is your homework. You have to do this homework. Okay. So what are the criteria on which you will differentiate them? You will differentiate the liquids, solids and gases on the basis of shape, volume and space between the particles, force of attraction between the particles, the movement of particles, the compressibility of the liquids and the rate of diffusion. There is one more parameter on which you can differentiate the solids, liquids and gas, that is density. Look, density is a parameter, or we can say density is a property that shows the heaviness of something, some matter. For example, look, density is actually the amount of mass present in a known volume or unit volume of a substance. For example, you take two bottles of 1 liter, you take two water bottles of 1 liter, means having same volume. Alright, and in suppose both the bottles have 1 liter volume, and you take 1 liter water in this bottle and 1 liter honey in this bottle, which one will be heavier? This you need to know. Or you can also take mobile oil in place of honey in this bottle. So you have taken 1 liter water and 1 liter honey or mobile oil. You will find that the mass of 1 liter water is 1 kg. But the mass of 1 liter honey is more than 1 kg. Suppose it may be 1.5 kg, something. So which one is having more mass in 1 liter volume? That is honey, or that may be moil oil, any heavy type of liquid. So here you see that the amount of mass present in the same volume is more in honey. So we can say that the honey is more dense. Honey is more dense as compared to water. Got it? So this is how we can understand what is density. Now, we know that the density of solids is maximum, the density of liquids is intermediate, and the least density is of gases. You can have a clear-cut picture of all the three states. Here you see gases, the particles are moving with maximum space between them. Liquids, the particles are moving, but space between them is less. Force of attraction is more as compared to gas. Now the solids, the particles are fixed on their positions, but they are vibrating like this. Alright, here you can see the difference between the spaces, the movement of the particles of solids, liquids and gases. So thank you, dear students, for watching this video. This is enough. Already the video has been very long, that is around 32 minutes. So keep watching more videos. In the second part, we are going to discuss about the interconversions of states of matter. So here we are going to start with, that is in the next video, we will start with change of states of matter, that is interconversion of states of matter. Now, dear students, please remember the inputs that are given by me, that you need to study each topic from your NCERT book and make your own notes. Thank you.